الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، خير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، شر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And جزاكم الله خيرا for the kind invitation. The subject is very wealthy, rich subject, and approaching it is important from which perspective? Because normally when we tell stories, we don't tell them for entertainment. Rather, we tell them for learning. Stories are mentioned in the Quran, and they were meant to convey a message. The story we have tonight is the story of Salman radiallahu anhu, someone who used to be proud of his identity as a Muslim. When he would hear these Arab men around him, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sometimes taking pride in their tribes and their families, he used to tell them, أبي الإسلام لا أبا لي سواه إذا ما تباهوا بقيس أو تميم. My ancestor, my father is in Islam. I have no other father than in Islam, even if you take pride in Qais and Tamim. The story of Salman radiallahu anhu is a story of a noble companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who did not settle until he reached the truth. He seeked it, and he had to leave travel. He had to be a stranger. He had to move from one place to another in order to
Assalamu alaikum. My humble request to all the sisters that please pay undivided attention to the speaker. The noise level is just too high for the brothers to listen over here. Sheikh is traveling all the way from Colorado. So let's give some respect to our dear brother and dear Sheikh and listen to the beautiful story of Salman Farsi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So please keep the noise level close to zero. Jazakumullahu khairan. And all the brothers who are sitting in the back, if I may request all of them to move up, inshallah, so that will be helpful. Jazakumullahu khairan.
One of the best badges that Salman radiallahu anhu earned is the following. when Salman radiallahu anhu was deprived from participating in both battles, Badr and Uhud, and finally he was freed from slavery. The reason why he did not participate because he was enslaved. Came his turn in a battle called the Alliance or Al-Ahzab. And this was his best, greatest contribution to Islam. When the Muslims were attacked by almost 10,000, army of 10,000, double almost the population of Medina. And Salman radiallahu anhu introduced that new concept of digging a trench between two mountains to prevent the army from progressing. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in order to dig that trench, he divided the Muslims into two groups. One group called the Muhajirin and the other group called the Ansar. Now, where Salman belongs to, Muhajirin or Ansar? Salman came from Persia. So, technically, he did not come from Medina to be called Muhajir, even though he migrated. So they actually quarreled, because Salman also had a very good build. So he would be a good help for any group. Then the Prophet ﷺ came in and given Salman that beautiful badge when he said, Salman minna al bayt. Salman is from my family. What's an honor that he belonged to the family of the Prophet ﷺ. Like I said at the very beginning, when you approach a story, you can reflect upon so many things. But there is one side of the story of Salman that I want to leave tonight, and hopefully the brothers and the sisters in this room grasped it, digested it. And I'm going to introduce to it maybe 10 minutes. So just hang in there. I have not departed from the story of Salman. All of this is related to the story of Salman. في صحيح الإمام مسلم حديث عياض ابن حمار المجاشعي رضي الله عنه. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, Allah سبحانه وتعالى says, this is what we call حديث قدسي, حديث إلهي. إن الله نظر إلى أهل الأرض فمقتهم عربهم وعجمهم إلا بقايا من أهل الكتاب وفي لفظ بقايا من بني إسرائيل. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has looked into the people in earth and he resented them, whether they are Arabs or non-Arabs, except few from the people of the book. Here it is. كانوا على التوحيد, because they used to be on التوحيد. When did this look take place? The scholar said, right before the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is 600 years after the sending of Isa alayhi salatu wa sallam. In this hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about three races: the Arabs, the non-Arabs, and Bani Israel. Allah looked into people and he resented them. عربهم, the Arab, عجمهم, the non-Arab, إلا بقايا من أهل الكتاب, except few from أهل الكتاب. Let's look at the condition of the Arabs right before the prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What kind of religion they had? The Arabs for a long time used to follow the millah of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam and his son Ismail. So they used to worship one God and they used to follow the sharia of Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam for years. Until a man whose name is Amr ibn Luhay al-Khuza'i. Amr ibn Luhay al-Khuzai. He was known in the Arab community to be a very knowledgeable person, to the extent that they started saying he receives revelation from a jinni. Lahu jinni. Speaks to him. So he was respected. He traveled to Sham. Now we're going to repeat that word Sham all the time. When we say Sham, at this time it's called the Greater Syria, meaning Palestine, Lebanon, Jordan, and Syria. So this is Sham at the time. Sham right now, they broke it up. When the Brits came to the Arab world, they broke these up into four states, which is Lebanon, Jordan, four different countries. So when he went to Sham, the Greater Syria, he found them worshipping idols. He admired the idea, so he brought the idols back with him to the Arabian Peninsula. So he introduced the worship of idols to the Arabs. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi Sahih al-Bukhari says, Hadith Abi Huraira radiyallahu anhu, he said, the night of al-Mi'raj, the night of the Ascension, رَأَيْتُ عَمْرَ إِبْنَ لُحَيِّ الْخُزَاعِي فِي النَّارِ يَجُرُّ قُصُبًا. I saw Amr ibn Luhay, the night of the Ascension, Laylat al-Mi'raj in hell, dragging his intestines in hellfire. Why? فَإِنَّهُ كَانَ أَوَّلَ مَنْ بَدَّلَ دِينَ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. Because he was the first one who changed the religion of Ibrahim. وَهَذَا شَيْءٍ مَعْرُوفٍ, that when you introduce a bid'ah, مَنْ دَعَى إِلَى هُدَى, when you call people to guidance, everyone who does this, you receive a reward. Likewise, when you introduce an innovation or a bad thing in the religion and everyone does it after you, guess what? You receive the sin as well. Look, every murder, whether it happens in Harlem, in Cairo, in Karachi, every murder that happens in the face of this earth, guess who receives as a part of it? Who? The first son of Adam. كل نفس تقتل ظلما إلا وكان على ابن آدم الأول كفل منها فإنه أول من قتل. He was the first one to introduce killing. When he killed his brother. والحديث في البخاري حديث ابن عمر رضي الله عنه. Now, did everyone follow the worship of idols? No. رسولنا صلى الله عليه وسلم never worshipped idols. أبو بكر, عثمان, Abu Dhar al-Ghifari, there is actually one of the people whose name is Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl, who died before the prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His son, anyone knows his son? Who's the son of Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl? One of the companions who's giving glad tidings of Jannah. Huh? Sa'id. That's his son. Sa'id ibn Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl. Zayd ibn Amr, imagine, Ibu, wallahi, it's one of the most troubling things that you will be looking for guidance when it's all dark. No one to show you the light. No one to show you the way. Zayd ibn Amr, subhanallah, Asma, bint Abi Bakr, radiallahu anha, said, رَأَيْتُهُ شَيْخًا كَبِيرًا. I saw him, an old man, leaning his back to the Kaaba, and he's telling, يَا مَعْشَرْ قُرَيْشِ, O Qurayshi, by Allah, no one on the millah of Ibrahim, on the way of Ibrahim, accept me. Accept me. And I'm proud of it. You can imagine you're the only Muslim in town and you're proud of it. Right now we have brothers and sisters who are Muslims and they have Muslims around them and they shy away. Zayd ibn Amr used to stand in the Kaaba. I'm a Muslim. I'm the only one on the way of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Not only this, he used, when an Arab wanted to kill his baby girl, he used to go to them and say, listen, don't kill her, please. Let me take care of her, and I'll grow up for her for you, and I'll give her back. وَكَانَ يُوقِدُ الْمَوْقُودَ. He used to rescue a lot of girls from burial. فابن عمر, Abdullah ibn Umar, and Sa'id, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they said, Ya Rasulullah, أَنَسْتَغْفِرُ لِزَيْد. Should we ask Allah to forgive Zayd? قَالَ نَعَمْ. He said, نعم, إنه يبعث يوم القيامة أمة واحدة. Imagine this. He will be resurrected in the day of judgment, an ummah by himself. Because he found the truth before the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. In spite of darkness. This is the Arab in grief. The overwhelming majority of them followed the bid'ah, which is the worship of idols, which Amr ibn al-Luhay al-Khuza'i introduced, except few, including our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who never prostrated to an idol. What about Bani Israel? The hadith also spoke about Bani Israel. You see, Bani Israel, when we say Ahlul Kitab, we mean Jews and Christians. Jews technically or already gone out of the fold of Islam by rejecting the message of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam and actually taking an attempt on his life, attempting to kill him. With this, they got out of the fold of Islam. So we call them kuffar already. So they are resented because they should have accepted the messengership and the message of Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Tayyib. We're left with those who followed the message of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. What happened to them? They broke into three groups. Three groups. One group said, yeah, the Trinity, the Father, the God, came into the flesh, what is known to Christians by incarnation, and then God sacrificed himself for the sins of the humans. Another group likewise. One group, you need to understand this, one group from the followers of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam said no to all of this. And a lot of them paid their lives for this. They said no. The true message of Prophet Isa alayhi salam is La ilaha illallah, Isa Rasulullah. That is the true message. Sun and Trinity and all that stuff. This is like a lot of Muslims now in America, they say, let's modify the religion, let's make it what, you know, let's make it American Islam. This is how Christianity, you see that the concept of Trinity was introduced in Christianity when Christianity went to Europe. Went to Europe, they said, we cannot accept that. We cannot take that. We have to change this. We have to take this from simply the tawheed, the oneness of Allah, into
question.
At the end.
What's the third group name?
Yeah, I'm coming to this. Yeah, questions at the end. Yeah. Do you have some time for questions? Yeah, questions at the end, because, you know, if you interrupt me, I have to go back now, and, you know, it's a recording. We have to put the recording on. Now I have to go back. You see, it's, yeah.
Three times a sunnah, it's okay.
Yeah. So now, where were I? I have to ask you now. I have no idea what were I. What was I talking about?
Went to Europe. You're talking about Christianity changed in Rome. Trinity
comes from Europe.
Okay. You see, that's the problem we're having here. Okay. So you need to realize that the religion of Isa alayhi salam, for the brother who's looking for, here are the three groups. And this is actually coming from Athar Abdullah ibn Abbas and Sa'id ibn Jubayr. That's not my talk. That's Sa'id ibn Jubayr narrated this from Abdullah ibn Abbas. That after Prophet Isa alayhi salam was raised up, the Christians divided into three groups. The first group is called the Ya'qubiyya, the Jacobites, yani in reference to Jacob. But Jacob is innocent from them. What did they say? They said, كان الله فينا. والعياذ بالله. Allah came down amongst us in the flesh of a human to take our suffering away, the Trinity. The second group called the Nusturiyya, or Nasturiyya, the Nusturites. They said, well, كان ابن الله فينا. So they did not say Allah, they did not say the Trinity, but they said what? The Son. They said Allah has a Son. The third group, they said, كان رسول الله عيسى بن مريم فينا, which is like us. رسول الله عيسى, the son of Maryam, was amongst us. ثم رفع إلى السماء, then he was raised up, and he will descend before the hour. Now the first two groups, those who said Allah has a son, and those who said that Allah is three, they united with the authorities. Very similar to what we're going through now. They worked with the authorities against what? The third group was in Tawheed. Now, some of those, they used to join good and forbid evil and stand out there and not being afraid. They were put to the cross and some of them were burned to death. The rest said what? You know what? Come on, leave us in peace. We're going to separate and go in our own outside. We're going to go and take sanctuaries. Huh? Then look at the Quran. وَرَحْبَانِيَّةً ابْتَدَعُوهَا Manship that they had as a scheme. Who heard the story of Juraij? Who knows? You know Juraij? Juraij, the worshipper? Juraij had somebody who was accused of adultery. Look at the karama. He punched the infant in his side and he asked him, who's your father? He said, not you. Hadi karama. Juraij was on tawheed. Like, you know the story of the boy of the king, don't you? Who knows the story of the boy of the king? And that boy got to learn the deen through who? Through Arahib, who was in Tawheed. He was a true follower of Prophet Isa. But he would go and he hide away, because if they would find out, they would kill him. They would execute him immediately. So those are the few basically Christians who were in Tawheed, which the Prophet ﷺ meant in his hadith, al-Hadith al-Qudsi. The third group, Salman, in a way, will give us a hint how they simply practice their deen. You know, the best, I always say this, the best way to enjoy the story of Salman, hear it from Salman. Actually, when he narrated his story to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet said to him, go and tell it to my companions. He loved it so much. He loved it so much. I'll try to depict Salman, but I'll try to be Salman right now in front of you. القصة أخرجها ابن إسحاق في السير ويعني it's a good شيء بإذن الله تعالى. He said, كنت أعيش في أصفهان. Salman said, I used to live in Asfahan. Where is Asfahan now? Iran. In a place called G. In a town called G. Now, in Iran, in Asfahan, they used to worship the fire. So they used to be Majus, worshippers of the fire, Magians, they called them. And his father used to be the mayor, Dahqan, the mayor of the town. وَكَانَ قَيِّمُ النَّارِ One of the responsibilities of the mayor, besides taking care of the problems and resolving issues between his citizens, or he would also take care of the guard, make sure that the guard doesn't die, make sure that the fire is what? Is always on. Salman was so devoted to the worship of the fire, to the extent that his father given him that responsibility. He said, Salman, make sure that the fire doesn't die. So his father one day was so occupied with the village and taking care of the problems of the town. So Salman decided this day to go out and wander in his own. But he is passing by a building. He didn't know, but he heard a beautiful, touchy voice coming out of that building. In reality, some people inside there were reciting the Zabur, the Psalms. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Zabur to Prophet Dawood, alayhi salatu wassalam, because Prophet Dawood had a beautiful voice. Even when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would praise some of his companions, like Abi Musa al-Ash'ari of the Allah, when he hears him recite the Quran, he said, لَقَدْ أُعْطِيتَ مِزْمَارًا مِنْ مَزَامِيرِ آلِ دَاوُودِ You're giving an instrument of Dawood, alayhi salatu wasalam. Ikhwal, subhanAllah, a lot of our children now are tuning to music and baby and all that stuff. Subhanallah. Wallahi, if they pay attention to the Quran, you know the brother who recited these beautiful verses from Al Imran before we started. Allahu Akbar. Look at his voice. Huh? You heard him reciting the verses, Al Imran? Beautiful. You know? I see a lot of youth in the gathering. instead of الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم says من لم يتغنى بالقرآن فليس منا. Whoever does not purify his voice with the Quran, he is not one of us. You need to understand that the Torah, when it was revealed, is a book of law. The Torah is a book of law. When you recite it, there is no, you cannot beautify your voice with it. Because you're reading what? Imagine you're reading a book of law. Now, the Psalms doesn't contain any laws. The Psalms are what? Even they call it songs. The songs of Dawood. Why? Because it meant what? It meant to write. You see, subhanAllah, this is the miraculous thing about the Quran. It combines both. Law and you, imagine this, imagine, wallahi, if you read the translation of these verses, you're going to give up understanding it, because it's like law of inheritance. But look how the law of inheritance is worded in the Quran. يوصيكم الله في أولادكم للذكر مثل حظ الأنثيين فإن كن نساء فوق اثنتين فلهن ثلثا ما ترك. This is law. Actually, if you translate these words, man, you're going to give up understanding it. But look how it sounds. Salman got so attracted to this beautiful recitation of his Zabur. So he went inside and he said, who are you? He said, we are Christians. So there are Christian missionaries basically in Iran. What religion do you? Christianity. Look, where is the source of this religion? Where this religion started? They said in Sham again. Sham is always, you see, you got this area, that's why it's a hot zone. And a lot of people don't understand why it's a hot zone. I was asked this question yesterday. I was in giving a lecture to non-Muslims in Colorado Springs. And I said, why you guys are so uptight about everything in the Middle East? I said, listen, you know a volcano? You know a volcano? This is the fountain of the volcano out there. We are here in America like the last wave, basically. Imagine the volcano does. Well, over there, man, you breathe religion. You know Tawheed? Tawheed in the air. Even if the society is corrupt, wallahi. Wallahi, Tawheed is in the air out there. You don't know how. It's out there. Even if you see corruption in the street, but you smell Tawheed. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordains that all the religions, they came out of where? Egypt and Palestine and Sham and Iraq, this area. That's why it's hot. Fighting, killing. Allahu Akbar. Al-Shahid, Salman wanted to go where? I want to go to the source. I want to go to the source there. The source of the religion. He actually told them, please, can you take me there when you travel? But he made a big mistake. He went back home and he shared his story with his father. He was actually, father, you know, he found the truth. Father, you know, I found those people worshiping. But because in reality, you need to understand something. Christians do believe in a God. Be careful. They do believe in a God. But they distorted the concept of the God. They made it what? A human God. They brought him down from the throne. They got him into the flesh of a human being and they killed him for their sins. Imagine this. Yeah? How selfish this is. I mean, but we should say this in a nice way, okay? Be nice. Huh? Because I'm talking to Muslims, I'm speaking like this. But I wouldn't speak like this to Christians. So, when you hear somebody speaking of a God, you compare this with who? With a fire god. That you are trying, Salman, subhanAllah, managed on the same day to flee and untie his shackles, and he joined that caravan in his way to the greater Syria. So when he arrived Syria, he joined a church there. But look at the test, subhanAllah, look at the test. His first, you know, sometimes the people who are looking for the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes them face trials and tribulations. They don't reach for the truth right away. You know, like, subhanAllah, somebody, you know, you're looking to really be a devoted Muslim. You want to be a devoted Muslim. And you end up joining this imam, and you end up finding this imam doing what? Doing something bad. So, you know what? That Islam is not good. ولذلك يا إخوة, one of the worst things that you do, if you say Allah said, the messenger said, that you do not combine this with actions. This is what Salman was faced with. As soon as he arrived and he joined that church, the priest used to steal the money. And Salman used to see him hiding that money. So, ولذلك subhanAllah, Usama ibn Zayd narrates that a man in the day of resurrection, his intestines, look at the scene, will come out of his ears. You know the intestines, right? Lamar will come out of the ears. And he will go around it like a donkey goes around a grinder. فَيَدُورُ حَوْلَهَا كَمَا يَدُورُ الْحِمَارُ فِي الرَّحَى. So the people will come to him, يَا فُلَان, oh so and so, weren't you enjoining good and forbidding evil? Weren't you telling us to do this and not to do this? And he said, better, yes, but I used to tell you to do stuff, but I wouldn't do it. And I used to ban you from doing stuff, and I did it. The worst. كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَن تَقُولُ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. The most hated, resented act in the sight of Allah, that you say what you do not do. أتأمرون, look at the ayah. أتأمرون الناس بالبر وتنسون أنفسكم وأنتم تتلون الكتاب أفلا تعقلون. Have you no sense? فسلمان was what? Faced with this. That's his first fitna. So here he is coming all the way from Iran to Sham looking for the truth. And he lands at a place where there is a trial for him. Now, did this turn Salman away? No, it did not. He insisted that there is a mismatch between the guidance and between the individual. And this is unfortunately what a lot of Americans are not concluding. You know, Americans right now, they are looking for the religion. They are really interested in Islam. But what they see like this man, Muslims who are, well, really not practicing Islam, Muslims by name. So they say, no, that's not a good religion. You see, that's the bottom line. But this did not turn Salman away from the truth. He still insisted that the truth is still there. But this man is just not following the truth. That you try to separate between the manhaj, between the deen, and the followers of the deen. Sometimes you find people who are not following the deen. In any rate, when that priest passed away, when that priest died, they are about to bury him. Salman has to reveal the truth. He went and he said, listen, this guy used to steal your money, and he piled almost 7 jars of gold and silver, and he showed them the place. He hid them right here. They decided actually to crucify him, put him on the cross, instead of burying him. Salman says the one who took over was so pious and righteous. He even, one of those zuhad, he renounced the dunya. I enjoyed learning the religion from him. I spent a lot of good time with him. When he was about to die, I went by his bedside and I said, by Allah, the only one I know to be righteous and pious is you. And before you die, he gotta tell me where to go. He says, by Allah, just to show you that not many people were on the truth at this time, and this is what is meant by the hadith which I started with, illa baqaya min ahli al-kitab, except some left over from the people of the book. He said, by Allah, I don't know anybody who is in my religion on tawheed in this town. Now I advise you to go up to a place called al-Musil. Al-Musil is between Syria and Syria and Turkey in that area. Or, you know, the Musil that is known to us in Syria, we have 2 locations. One of them between Syria and Turkey, and another one which is in Iraq. Go there. So he went there, subhanAllah, as soon as he arrived, this man also was about to die. He went by his bedside and he said, by Allah, I'm afraid I'm going to go astray. You're a good man. You're a righteous man like the man I left. please, like the man who died, who I left before, left me with a will. You gotta tell me where to go. Who else should you go? He said to him, go to somebody in a place called Nusaybin. This is in Turkey. Imagine he's moving. Let's say that in Mosul in Iraq, not in, in Mosul, Syria, in Mosul in Iraq. So he moved from Jerusalem to Iraq to now he's going to Turkey. Nusaybin is in Turkey. Imagine this. He's moving around for his deen, for his religion. He's looking for the deen. He's looking for the truth. Yet he did not find it. But he found it in those people of the book who still stick to the teachings of Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wassalam, the teachings of Tawheed. So the man in Nusaybin, when he was about to die again, he went to him and he said, by Allah, let me know where to go. Where should I go after this? He said, the only one I know is in a place called Amuriya. Amuriya again is in somewhere between Turkey and Syria. But this time, when he went to Amuriya, as if, mashallah, he developed knowledge, he decided to do something, he decided to work. And subhanAllah, he ended up actually with some savings. He ended up with a cow and some sheep. So, when that scholar in Amuriya was about to die, listen carefully here. He went to him and he said, by Allah, you gotta tell me what to do. He said, by Allah, I don't know anyone in the face of this earth in Tawheed. As if he was the last man on Tawheed. He's a follower of La ilaha illallah, Isa Rasulullah. Now remember when I said the three groups, those are the leftovers. But listen, this is the time of the appearance of a prophet from the offspring of Ismail. Look at this now. ذاك يا إخوة هذا الحديث, this hadith, the story of Salman. الإمام بايهقي compiled in his book دلائل النبوة, the evidence for the prophethood of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Imagine this man is, look at this now. He will migrate. Migrate. But there is a verse we recite in Surah Al-A'raf, we don't pay attention to. الذين يتبعون الرسول النبي الأمي الذي يجدونه مكتوبا عندهم في التوراة والإنجيل. Those who follow the prophet, the messenger, the electorate, the one whom they found written in the Torah and in the Gospel. Written. Muhammad والله is written in the Torah and the Gospel. His description. They're not only Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you and me. Have you read the last verse in Surah Al-Fath? Huh? Muhammad Rasulullah. والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم تراهم ركعا سجدا يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانا. Look at سيماهم في وجوههم من أثر السجود ذلك مثلهم في التوراة. This is how, why when the Sahaba would arrive to another country, right away the whole country becomes Muslims. Why? Because these are the guys that we read about. They look like this. But look at Muslims now, how they look. I'm sorry, I'm not being sarcastic. We have Muslim youth now who go around, their pants hanging around their reef. That's their example in the Torah. Or shaving his ass in the mogu. The mogu is having the mogu. Mogu or mogu, something like that? Muhar. Muhar. Where is their likeness in the Torah? Allahu Akbar. And we're wondering why non-Muslims are not accepting Islam. Yeah, he look like the Sahab. Why the priest in Jerusalem insisted that Umar must come and be handed over the key of Kaaba, the key of Masjid al-Aqsa? Why? Because it's written.
Said, listen, it's written that you guys are going to come and take these keys away from us, but we are instructed to hand it over to your Amir. That's why Abu Ubaidah called Abu Umar. That's why a lot of, they say Islam went by the sword. Yeah, as soon as they entered the town, man, these are the guys that we read about in our religious books. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Right away. What about the Prophet? Wallahi, his description. Hear this. يا أيها النبي إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا وحرزا للأميين سميتك المتوكل أنت عبدي ورسولي لست بفض ولا غليظ ولا صخاب بالأسواق بل تعفو وتصفح. This is actually the book of Isaiah. I just recited the book of, this is the description of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم according to Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As رضي الله عنه. Look at this man, he's telling him, listen, the description of the place, he will, for your information, the Prophet ﷺ did not know that he will migrate to Mecca, but just 1 year before it, according to the book of Sir. 1 year before it. He said, إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ مَكَانَ هِجْرَتِكُمْ. After he went to Taif and went to these places, he used to go during the season of Hajj and ask the people, help me, host me, I want to convey the message of Allah. Then at last, he said, I have seen in my dream the place where you're supposed to migrate to. مَكَانٌ بَيْنَ حَرَّتَيْنِ. A place between two volcanic mountains. اللي هي المدينة. Look at this. The people of the book know about that place. I want to ask you a question. Why did the Jews come to Medina? Come on, brothers, why? And you want to know something? The most knowledgeable of the Torah of them came to Medina. You know where did they come from? From where?
Yemen.
After the Ma'rab, that water dam was collapsed, said Ma'rab, they have to migrate. They have to go somewhere. They went to Medina, out of the old peninsula, because they knew that this is the place where the Prophet is coming to. And they used to tell the Ansar, نَحْنُ فِي انْتِظَارِ نَبِيٍ. We're waiting for a Prophet. When he comes, we're going to fight you. Why Ansar was the first people who, when the Prophet asked them to actually host him, they were triggered. You see, you need to understand here that the Arabs, like I said, used to go and perform Hajj according to the Millah of Ibrahim. The people of Yathrib, the people in Medina used to go too. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to utilize the season of Hajj, and he would go around and he would say, I am the messenger of Allah. If you can host me, please, so I can convey the message of Allah. So he stopped by the camp. You know, they used to have camps like we do now. The American camps, the European camps. But this is the tribe from Medina. This is the tribe. So as soon as they heard him, they looked at one another and they said, what? Ya Layla Dir. They didn't say that. But this is the prophet the Jews are talking about in Medina. Let's host him, take care of him, so he will help us against him. Against them. That's the message that I really wanted you to get tonight. That they had the truth about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look at this. This is a Christian follower of Isa, about the true message of Isa. He's telling him, look, the description of the place is what? Is a place between two volcanic mountains, بين حرتين وفعلا المدينة. Even when they dug the trench, they did not dig the trench, the four corners of the city. They only one side. Look at the other description. ذَاتِ نَخْلٍ. A lot of palm trees. And Medina, before all these constructions, if you look at Medina, a lot of palm trees. Not only the description of the place. Listen, this prophet doesn't accept sadaqah. But he would accept a gift from you. And he has between his two shoulders a stamp of prophethood. بَيْنَ كَتِفَيْهِ خَاتَمُ النُّبُوَّةِ. Look for these signs. Salman immediately wanted to go to that place in the Arabia. He looked around for a caravan traveling to the Arabia. He finally found one. And he said to them, خُذُوا بَقَرَاتِي وَغُنَيْمَاتِي. Take my investment. Imagine Allah Salman هذا يا إخوة. والله آية من آيات الله سبحانه وتعالى. يعني سلمان هذا إذا صار صار. Look at this, his savings. He worked for to have a cow and some sheep. He said, take my cow and my sheep. Just take me to that place. They said fine, and they did something else. They enslaved him. They sold him in slavery. وذلك سبحان الله ورد في البخاري يا إخوة أن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said ثلاثة أنا خصمهم. Three individuals and their opponent in the day of resurrection. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. رجل باع رجل. That someone who's free, you turn him into a slave. But subhanAllah, he was sold to a Jew who used to live in the outskirts of Medina. So when he was passing by Medina, he felt that this is the place, but he was uncertain. So Salman was serving his master, the Jewish master. And the Jewish master, look at the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, used to have a family member from Bani Qurayzah, which is a tribe that lives within Medina. So he came to visit her, and he saw how Salman is a good slave, very well disciplined, he hears and he obeys. He said, بِعْنِي هَذَا الْعَبْدِ. Tell me, sell me that slave. So he sold it to him. So he was transferred from the outskirts to Bani Qurayza inside Medina. Until now, the Prophet ﷺ did not migrate. He's still just doing his job, going about his life. But all of a sudden, he said, I was in the top of a palm tree. And someone came from Medina visiting my master. And then he said this, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ أَبْنَاءَ قُتَيْلَ. قُتَيْلَ, by the way, is also a woman who used to live in Yemen, unlike the Jews, she migrated. And she came to Yathrib. And she had two children, Al-Aws and Khazraj. But Al-Aws and Khazraj are children of one mother. But this is the combination now. I don't want to be anti-Semitic here. Al-Akhir is recording. Look at the two brothers. وَكُلُّ لَذِيبٍ بِالْإِشَارَةِ يَفْهَمُ. المهم, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ أَبْنَاءَ قُتَيْلَ. May Allah curse the children of Qutaylah. They are hosting a man they call a prophet. And they are making a lot of noise around him. Look at the reaction of Salman. When I heard this, I shaked like a chill went through my spinal. You know, that's it. That's the truth. The Prophet is here. That's what I was. He said, I was about to fall down from the top of the tree. So I came down, and it's the first time he asked, oh, what did you say? Who is he? Where did he come from? What is he? And then his master got really mad at him, got upset at him. I said, go about your business. Go and work. Salman now was so keen in making sure that this is the right person. So the first day he went to him in Masjid Qiba and he took some dates with him. And he looked to him, looked at him and he said, I can tell that you're poor and your companions cannot take a good care of you. I brought some sadaqah for you, some donation for you. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at him and smiled. And he took the sadaqah from him and he gave it to his companions. He did not eat from it. But the message is that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not allowed to even accept sadaqah. Hatta when he would go home and he would see a date, he would ask, a sadaqah am hadiyya? Who brought this sadaqah? No, it's a gift. He would accept the gift. But sadaqah, donation, no. And this is for a wisdom. You know, one of the main principles of a messenger, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا. I'm not asking you for a wage. I'm not asking you for a fee. الشاهد, Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم refused to accept the sadaqah. The following day he came to him in his masjid, just to show you that it took a duration of time. In Masjid al-Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he brought with him some dates this time. And he said to him, listen, last time I offered you some dates as a sadaqah and I noticed that you did not eat it. Now this is a gift from me to you. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam samba bismillah and he ate it. So he said, this is two. Would you wait for the three? Yes. See that. You gotta be careful. You gotta be careful with whom you study and whom you learn the deen. The most precious thing is your deen, is your religion. Don't just take it just like that. This sheikh said that, that person said that. You actually verify, learn, found out, find out. Right now, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells you that we're going to break into 73 sects. 70 of two of them are callers to hell. Imagine you have 73 doors. Imagine this, 73 doors. And at the entrance of each door, destination paradise, welcome to Jannah. Yet we're going to take you to Jannah. Come here. And you enter inside that door and you end up with a hell. There's only one door to Jannah. One door to Jannah. Very careful. Salman yet wanted to verify the third sign. He came back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam while the Prophet was sitting in Baqi' al-Gharqad, in the place where they buried the deceased, fil Baqi' yani. He was wearing sallallahu alaihi wasallam some clothes and yani, he wanted to look and see if he can pick that stamp, the stamp of prophethood behind his shoulder. So he kept looking right and left. And then finally, the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam noticed. Then he said to him, are you looking for this? And he showed it to him. Salman immediately broke in tears. And he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. He finally found the truth. He reached it. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam can tell that, you know, that he was so affected by the scene. And he asked him, what is your story? What has happened? He actually told him all the story that I told you right now, but I'm sure he told it much better than me. He told it in a better way, to the extent that the Prophet ﷺ admired it so much, and he said, please tell it to my companions. Tell it to my companions. Because it proves something to them. It proves that Rasulullah ﷺ was written in these previous books, and he is to be followed. Now Salman was still enslaved. One day, the Prophet ﷺ returned from one of the battles and he asked his companions, مَا صَنَعَ صَاحِبُنَا الْفَارِسِ. What happened to our companion, the Persian? They said, Ya Rasulullah, he's enslaved. Call him for me. So he came. And Rasul ﷺ said to him, كَاتِبْ يَا Salman. Go and try to make a deal with your master so he can free you. So he went back to his master asking for his liberty and freedom. He said to him, I will give it to you if you plant 300 palm trees. And he gave me 40 ounces of gold. Imagine all of this. So Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he heard this, he called upon his companions, Man yusa'ad sahibuna? Who can help our companion? So a companion stood up and he said, I'll give him 30, you know, the baby palm trees that you need to plant. I'll give him 30, I'll give him 40, I'll give him 50. So they compiled, they collected these 300 palm trees and he said to them, don't plant them. And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with his hand took the palm tree, so as if they prepared the hole, and they put the palm tree next to it, he would go down and take the palm tree and plant it. Plant it, plant it. In one of the wording of this hadith, that Umar did plant one. And this is the only one which did not grow. No, something wrong with Umar. But subhanAllah, barakatul Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In general, by the way, in general, if you're a farmer and if you know the business of palm trees, normally 70% of it do die. So the ratio is actually 30%. That you plant 100, you end up with 30. And 70, imagine with the Rasulullah ﷺ, the percentage was what? This is not in a way, yani, that in the side of Umar, because that's the ratio. That's what you get. and actually one of the conditions in one of the wording of this hadith, one of the conditions of the Jewish master that it must grow, must bring fruits before I can free you. Like dates must come out. They tell you that the dates came out the first year. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam noticed that one of them is not growing or is not producing. He actually took it out and planted again. Now later on the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came back from a battle and he brought with him an egg of gold. And he called Abu Salman and he said, go and pay your debts. With this, Ya Ikhwa, Salman was freed. And subhanAllah, as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala freed him for the right time, for the right position. He missed on the battle of Badr. He missed on in the battle of Uhud because he's a slave. He has to get the approval of his master. But when the disbelievers united, that's why it's called the Ahzab, the alliance, in order to wipe Islam from the face of this earth, when they came marching towards Medina, the Muslims didn't know what to do. They said to Rasulullah, what are we going to do? Even the numbers of the people in Medina is not sufficient to face that army. And then Salman introduced that brilliant idea, which he imported just to show you, regardless of who you are, regardless of what language you speak, regardless of what color you are, you can always contribute to this religion. As long as we come under the umbrella of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. قال يا رسول الله, he said to Messenger of Allah, when we're attacked in Persia, in positions like this, we used to dig a trench. Dig a trench. And subhanAllah, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam divided the Muslims into groups, al-Muhajirin wal-Ansar. And I shared with you the badge of Salman, but I want to share with you, and I don't know if the brother meant this or not, the brother who recited the verses. The Muslims came across a huge rock that they could not break. So immediately they reported the matter to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and he took the axe and he hit the rock. You know when metal and rock collides, what happened? Sparks. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, Allahu Akbar! Futiha al-Qusur Kisra. I can see the Muslims in the land of the Virgin, in the palace of Kisra. Allahu Akbar! Futiha al-Qusur Rum. I can see the Muslims taking over the palaces in the Rum, in al-Sham. Allahu Akbar! Futiha al-Qusur al-Yaman. Al-Yaman is taken over by the Muslims. But the hypocrites, look at these guys, they cannot even fight. They are digging a trench that they cannot fight, and he's talking about Virgia or Rome. What is this? I don't know if the brother recited the verse or not. Then Allah revealed these verses. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وتنزع الملك ممن تشاء وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير. Who is the king? Allah. He appoints the king. It's not your business. You have to take time. But did it happen or no? Did the Muslim talk over Yemen? Huh? SubhanAllah, CNN just 3 days, 4 days ago. Did you hear that? The year 2070, Islam will be the largest religion in the face of this earth. SubhanAllah, how? Huh? How? Imagine if the Muslims doing their job. Imagine. It's going to happen more than quicker than this. فَهَذَا دِينُ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. This is the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَسُبْحَانَهُ, when the Muslims quarreled where Salman belongs to, whether he's Muhajir or Ansari, here is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and gave him that badge. سَلْمَانُ مِنَّا آلَ الْبَيْتِ. Salman is from me. Salman, ya ikhwa, was knowing of his knowledge and his fiqh. Huh? when he was freed, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put him with Abu Darda, and I close with this inshallah, with Abu Darda. Abu Darda noticed that Salman noticed that Abu Darda is not taking care of his family. He prays the Hajj every night. He fasts every single day. But Salman did not like that. So he said to him, "Ya Abu Darda, you know, in the morning he was fasting. He said, I would like to eat." So he brought him breakfast. And then he said, "Eat with me, please." So he ate with him. He said, "I'm fasting." He said, "No, break your fast." At night, Abu Darda is trying to pray tahajjud all night long. He said, "Please come and sleep. Just sleep. Then wake up at night. Then wake up later on and pray tahajjud with me." So he kind of disciplined Salman. Salman disciplined Abu Darda and his manner of worship. Abu Darda felt bad about it, that here I'm abandoning fasting every single day and praying tahajjud every single night. So he said, "Let me go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and ask him about this." So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he heard the story, he said to Abu Darda, "Uwaynan Salmanu afqahu mink." Salman has a better understanding of the religion than you. And he said to him, "Inna li ahlika alayka haqqa, wa inna li badanika alayka haqqa, wa inna li jad, wa inna li dhayfika alayka haqqa, فأدي أو فأعطي لكل ذي حق حق." Everyone has a right upon you. Yes, Allah has a right upon you. But do not allow the right of Allah deprive the people from the rights. Strike a balance between your ibadah and fulfilling your obligations towards your family, towards your body, towards your guest. This is our hero, Salman, the seeker of the truth. That story should invite all of you to appreciate the ni'mah of Islam. Look what Salman had to do to reach La ilaha illallah. Here you are having it. Appreciate it. It's a ni'mah. It's a shame if you think the only bounties that Allah bestow upon you is water and food and car and house. La. Kafa bil Islam ni'mah. What other ni'mah than in Islam that you have? But take care of it. Don't neglect it. Fulfill the obligations of that religion. جزاكم الله خيرا. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت. أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والحمد لله رب